స్లైడ్ షో పెట్టండి.
ఓకే, షల్ యు స్టార్ట్?
ఇది స్లైడ్ షో పెట్టండి రాజు గారు.
కనిపిస్తుంది సైడ్స్ లో ఉంది, ఆల్రెడీ ఇట్ ఇస్ బీయింగ్ సీన్.
లేదు
స్లైడ్ షో అది, ఐ యామ్ నాట్ ఏబుల్ టు.
సరి కనపట్టలేదు.
నౌ సార్?
లేదండి. ఇట్స్ ఓకే, గో అహెడ్.
So, hearty welcome to Dr. Sharmista Banerjee, Assistant Professor, Department of Design, Indian Institute of Technology, Guwahati, and Dr. Voice Reddy Garu, HOD, Professor and BOI Chairman at Department of Civil Engineering, Civil Engineering College, and respected all dignitaries, respected participants from reputed all engineering colleges and also other colleges. You are welcome to the session 11 by respected Dr. Sharmista Banerjee, Madam Assistant Professor, IIT Guwahati, who is going to give lecture on design thinking for sustainable project design. I request now Mr. Sudhir Kumar, Assistant Professor from Department of Civil Engineering, Sri Vidyanikatan Engineering College, to introduce Dr. Sharmista Banerjee Madam this lecture.
Thank you, sir. Good afternoon, Dr. Madam. My privilege to introduce Dr. Sharmista Banerjee.
Your voice is not audible, Sudhir.
Is it okay, sir, now?
Yeah.
So Dr. Sharmista Banerjee is an industrial designer with an experience in working in collaborative innovation.
Lot of noise. Lot of noise.
Excuse me, sir. Sorry. Is it okay now, sir?
Yes.
Okay. So currently, she is working as an assistant professor at Department of Design, Indian Institute of Technology, Guwahati. Dr. Sharmista Banerjee had received her PhD degree in Design for Sustainability in the arena of scale appropriate agriculture equipment design from IIT Guwahati. She did her bachelor in industrial design from IIT Guwahati, a master in integrated product design from Technical University of Delft, Netherlands. Dr. Sharmista Banerjee has co-founded the Sustainability and Social Innovation Lab at Department of Design, IIT Guwahati. The lab focuses on creating systems for sustainable human consumption and production through a complete revamp of the consumption structure with our design interventions. They are all the part of the global network on sustainability, the learning and education network in sustainability, consisting of 150 plus global universities. Currently, a large part of our sustainable product service development projects are in the domain of agriculture. At IIT Guwahati, she teaches courses like system design for sustainability, usability engineering, user research techniques, product detailing, interaction design, design management, plastics and composites, and design semantics. She has also developed a MOOC course on system design for sustainability, which had more than 600 subscribers in the academic year of 2018-19. In the past few years, she has worked in India, Bangladesh, and Netherlands with companies like Philips, Infosys, Micro, VU Medical University Amsterdam, Compax were packing Beet Belly and Botanist turned Delft, ACC Limited, education institutes like IIT Guwahati, MIT Institute of Design Pune, IDC, IIT Bombay, and L'Ecole de Design Indian Operations, Nantes, Atlantic, France, and NGOs like International Development Enterprise, Bangladesh. So with this, I conclude. Thank you for this opportunity. So I request Hemal sir to take over the session. Thank you, sir.
Thank you,
Sudhir
Kumar. Now I request
thank you so much. Thanks for the introduction. Thanks for the welcome. It's a pleasure to see all of you over here. So let's start our discussion. I will share my screen. Okay. So is my screen visible?
Yes, madam.
So I'm going to speak about design thinking for sustainable product design. When we talk about product design, so nowadays, whether the product is tangible or intangible, and whatever be the domain, everything is called as product. So whether it is a architectural space or whether it is a software or a tangible product like a car or a chair, so everything falls under the same category. So it's a generic terminology, product design. So a brief introduction about our team at IIT Guwahati. So we belong to the Department of Design. In the department, we have a lab which we call as Sustainability and Social Innovation Lab. Professor Ravi Mukashi Punekar, Dr. Pankaj Upadhyay, and myself are the three members at that particular lab. We call it as Sustainability and Social Innovation Lab because we do not look only at the production side, because unsustainabilities can of course be caused due to manufacturing processes, as well as the pollution caused due to production or the material consumption at the production phase. But more importantly, it is the consumption which drives the production. So if we do not consume consciously, we cannot solve the problem of sustainability. So in order to achieve any sustainable solution, we need the involvement of people. We need their involvement at conscious consumption. We also need their involvement in doing a paradigm shift of how consumption happens. So that's why we look at sustainability in technical terms, as well as from the perspective of the society, of the people involved. We are part of a network, a global network. It is called as LENS Network, Learning and Education Network in Sustainability. So we started as a consortium of 36 universities from Europe, Asia, Africa, South America, and Central America in 2015. We came together with because of the Erasmus Plus funding from the European Union. And the network has now grown to more than 200 universities from across the globe. So as part of this initiative, we have this lab which consists of certain infrastructure, both software as well as hardware and books and other material like case studies and tools that we keep on developing. The whole mandate of the lab is help grow the culture of sustainability, the knowledge related to sustainability. If some of your students are working on some research project where they require some kind of help related to, let's say, using Cima Pro or Gabi, which are software meant for sustainability assessment, environmental sustainability assessment, they can also get aid. Yes, of course, we cannot share the software in an offline context. So it has to be done more like at our lab. Apart from that, we develop various teaching material. We also work on various projects, and as a result of which we develop case studies. All these are uploaded onto our websites. The first website is the international website, which has content from all our partnering institutes, and the second one is our lab's website. So we keep on uploading all these content. All the content is copyleft because we want anybody and everybody to be able to use the information. Now, coming to the context of sustainability, first we start with the concept of what is unsustainable. So it's very clear to anybody and everybody that this vehicle which runs on fossil fuel is not very sustainable because it causes air pollution and it runs on non-renewable resources. So we cannot continue at the rate at which we are polluting the environment, and we cannot also keep on extracting the non-renewable resource of energy forever and ever. For students, it is very difficult to get the concept of sustainability because of the fact that it is not as straightforward as the example that I just showed. So let's take some examples. So for example, in this case, there is no fossil fuel involved while the vehicle is running. But does that make the solution sustainable? The main challenges over here is the fact that the rickshaw puller usually does not own the rickshaw. So he has to rent the rickshaw on a per day basis from whoever owns the rickshaw, and a major part of his daily earnings goes in paying the rent for the vehicle. As a result of which, the rickshaw puller is constantly in a state of debt. He can never imagine to buy the rickshaw himself. So not very economically sustainable for him. It is not very physically sustainable for him, considering the Indian weather conditions, as well as the labor involved and the fact that he cannot buy enough nutritious food for himself. This solution is also not very apt as a solution for long distance travel. So if I need to travel from point A to B, which is beyond a certain number of kilometers, I cannot use this as an option. So I cannot call it as a sustainable solution. So it does have certain aspects of sustainability involved, like in the running phase, it is not using any kind of fossil fuel. But when a student has to look at the problem of sustainability, they have to consider much bigger pictures. Now, this one is still simple. Let's go to the next solution. This is an electric bike system. It's an example of a system from a city in Australia. So it's not specific to that system, but it is a generic example from this system. So anybody who wants to use this particular electric bicycle, they can pay for it at that point of time. So there is a payment terminal. One can swipe the card and take the bike, use it for the duration they want to use it, and then park it at another station. This has many sustainability benefits. For example, because it can be, one can also use the pedal, but one can also use the fact that this is an electric bike. So can cater to the requirement of a larger number of people. Each cycle can be used by a larger population. So rather than ownership, this is a shared system. So which implies that the embodied material and the energy can actually be used by a larger number of people. So the usage density increases. So the impact, environmental bad impact, or whatever the environmental impact is, divided over higher frequency of usages than what is the case in the context of using it just by owning it. So that is another sustainable aspect in this particular solution. However, let's say this particular solution works on some kind of battery technology, and the fact that electricity, let's say in our country, the majority of the electricity is produced by burning fossil fuels, and there are a lot of transmission losses in between. So is it a good solution? And batteries are, the current battery technologies are not very sustainable. If I have to again go for long distances, this is not a very apt solution. From country to country, the acceptability of a bicycle as a means of transportation can have different socioeconomic implications, or rather say psychological implications. So for example, in our country, it is looked down upon if somebody is cycling. So not like kids, But like a grown-up person who is cycling is seen to be somebody who has a lower economic strata. Whereas if you go to a country like Netherlands, a person might own two cycles or three cycles, and it's very perfectly normal even for the CEO or even for the prime minister of the country to go around cycling. So there is a kind of consumption related behavior, psychological factors, which can also come into picture. So usually all these things need to be considered. So it's the entire life cycle. So entire life cycle of the product, also the fact that social, environmental, and economic, they together make up the system sustainable or not sustainable. For example, CNG vehicles. Many cities have gone into CNG only for their public transportation. Now, at a point of time, it was seen that this is a very clean burning fuel. Only when after a few years back, a particular CSIR lab figured out that CNG vehicles produce carbon nanoparticles, which are carcinogenic. So there are times when there are technological limitations or the limitations of knowledge. What at a current point of time I might think is sustainable, when more knowledge, more research happens over there and more technological development happens, my today's solution might not be any longer a very sustainable solution. So when one is supposed to design for sustainability, one is also supposed to keep themselves quite abreast with latest development, technological development, scientific developments in any particular area. Now, this is a metro. Is this a sustainable solution? Again, there are certain aspects of sustainability, good sustainability involved, and certain aspects on which it is not sustainable. So it's very sustainable because it's a more efficient way of transporting larger number of people from point A to B. However, it does not give door-to-door transportation. So I might need a backup of other means of transportation in order to be able to accept this particular means of transportation. As discussed in the earlier context, again, the electricity mix of a particular country will determine how efficient it is. If the electricity mix is more biased towards fossil fuel, then again, there are lots of transmission losses, lots of efficiency related losses, which can also have a negative impact. So whenever a problem related to sustainability of a particular solution is to be assessed, one has to look onto several parameters throughout the entire life cycle and do a quantification of each of those processes and try to identify which one is more sustainable than other solutions in a given context. So from context to context, the sustainability will change, and nothing can be absolutely sustainable. Again, this is a solar powered vehicle. So although there is no non-renewable resource involved, the particular solution has problems like the battery technology, because that's not the most sustainable solution. It also results into lots of toxic emissions. At the end of the life of the battery, there is a lot of toxicity which needs to be dealt with. This is one of my favorite examples which I always ask people. So if I have a context wherein, so the context over here is a tea seller who has to sell tea on a running train. So the tea or coffee can be sold in the cooler. It can be sold in these paper cups with a plastic film in the inside so that the paper cup doesn't get damaged. And the third option, which is disposable plastic cups. So many people think through common sense that maybe the terracotta cup is the most sustainable. But If I look into the entire life cycle of each of these products, I will have a different answer. So a terracotta is not clay. Once it is baked, it becomes ceramic, so it is no longer soil. So it can be pulverized and made into smaller and smaller particles, but it cannot be used for growing crops. So it is not biodegradable. So is the case with the other products. The paper cups with a plastic lining, again, the paper part of it can be biodegraded, but there is a plastic film which is very thin, which cannot be removed out of it. So the entire cup will end up in a landfill, and in a landfill only anaerobic digestion happens. So in the absence of aerobic digestion, actually the paper cup also will not, it will rather result into release of methane, which is 25 times more a harmful greenhouse gas than CO2. Now if I consider the life cycle, the manufacturing phase of it, so a terracotta cup is made up of very fine soil, which is the silt, which is very good soil for growing crops as well. So rather than growing crops, the soil will be used for making these cups. The cups need to be baked at a very high temperature. Since most of these industries which make these baked clay items, they are unorganized and they use biomass to fuel their kilns, and the kilns are not really designed appropriately. The kilns result in a lot of energy wastage and create a lot of pollution. So a lot of embodied precious material, precious energy, and a lot of pollution. On top of that, each of these clay pot is definitely so much more heavier as compared to the other two solutions. They are also breakable, so they need certain amount of care while carrying them. So the number of damages possible is higher. Because they are not perfectly stackable, so the volume required, so the volume that they will occupy in a bag is way much more higher. So which means one can carry lesser number of these terracotta cups. Whereas the paper cups, their manufacturing processes have different implications. The plastic has different implications. So we need to go through the entire process. The plastic cups, they are made up of polystyrene, so they are actually recyclable. They cannot be recycled for food grade purposes, but they can be recycled for other purposes. However, collection is the main problem. So they are not produced, they are not used in densities and discarded in densities where collection and recycling can be done profitably. So one needs to consider the entire life cycle and do a life cycle assessment and try to find out in a given context if it is a good solution. A terracotta can be a good solution in case the cup is supposed to be reused and maybe in a stationary context. So if at home I use some glazed terracotta cups and I am going to take good care of them and clean them and keep on using them, then the whole scenario changes, because now the embodied material, energy and the pollution, they are distributed over larger number of usages. So the context changes, the level of impact changes, and then it might be a more sustainable solution than other competing solutions available which can be used at home. The three dimensions of sustainability are social, economic, and environmental. Only at the confluence I can have sustainability. So say, for example, if something is socially sustainable and economically sustainable, we call it as an equitable solution. So for example, growing crops using chemical fertilizers and pesticides have given rise to bumper crop production in our country, which has brought food security for the people. It has also increased the income of the farmers. But as the fertilizers and pesticides cause environmental pollution, slowly the productivity of the land has reduced. It has also polluted our water bodies. Also, due to increased cost of inputs for agriculture, the farmers fall under huge debts if the crop fails. So thus you can see that an equitable solution in the long run, if not environmentally sustainable, can disrupt the cycle of social and economic sustainability. However, it is not it does not mean that a sudden move into organic production is the solution. So say for example, recently the Sri Lankan government decided to all of a sudden move into organic farming. So they decided to not import any kind of chemical based fertilizers and pesticides. Now the sudden move cannot be again a sustainable solution, because if the current practices are in a certain manner, so if so say for example the country still doesn't have enough production of organic fertilizers, so if organic solutions are not available in enough quantity, if the farmers are not trained well in doing organic farming, then sudden adoption cannot happen. So in due to the sudden occurrence, the production will only go down drastically, can lead into economic distress as well as social distress for people. Whereas say states like so Meghalaya in so Sikkim had done this and Meghalaya is in the process of doing it, so they used a phased wise manner to prevent the purchasing of chemical inputs and slowly helping the farmers into adopting organic practices, getting them certified and creating markets for their products. So that is a more sustainable approach towards the whole problem. Now something which is socially sustainable and environmentally sustainable, we call that as a bearable solution. For example, organic farming is good for the environment and the health of consumers, but since production volumes are lower under the current circumstances of know-how in the field, the price of such products is very high. Also, we will not be able to feed our huge population with those volumes of production. Hence, due to lack of economic sustainability, the bearable solution will eventually fall down. Then something which is economically sustainable and environmentally sustainable, we call that as a viable solution. So example, services like Uber are very economical alternative to owning car. Since rather than owning a car, it pushes people towards more denser utilization of existing cars in the market. Greater environmental sustainability is possible than the otherwise large volumes of cars that will be bought by people and used very less. But we are all aware that various protests against these services have cropped up since car drivers realize that they have no insurance or any such benefit because of the nature of their contract with the company. So the car drivers realize that in the long run, they do not have any social security. So for any sustainable solution to be sustainable, it has to be sustainable on all the three pillars. However, this diagram doesn't imply that all the three dimensions will have equal importance in every context. In certain contexts, the economic sustainability might be more important and might have higher priority than the other two dimensions. So we have to try to balance that and look up that at in a given context, which one needs higher priority than the others. So usually in a developing country context, people's biggest concern is because the paying capacities are lower, that firstly a solution has to be economically sustainable. Then the next concern comes related to the social sustainability, related to health of people, well-being of people, and other aspects related to humans and communities. And then the next aspect becomes, okay, environmental sustainability. Why do we need to move towards sustainability? So the ice caps are disappearing. We constantly keep on hearing about it. But something that we don't keep on hearing about so often is the number of premature death because of air pollution in a year around the globe. So it was estimated in 2016 to be around 6.5 million people per year, which is like the numbers that were lost during the world wars. So that's how grave the scenario is. The Food and Agricultural Organization also reported that globally we are seeing a rise in undernourishment due to food productions falling down. If we look at this particular chart, which shows if the world's population lived like how everybody in Australia lives, then we would require 5.2 Earths. So we require that much of resources. Indians live the way, if everybody on this planet lived the way Indians live, then we would require 0.6 Earth. The global population right now on an average requires 1.7 Earths, which is of course not available to us, so we need to look at sustainability. The most famous definition of sustainable development is development that meets the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs. Most of you must be aware of this particular definition. But what people are mostly not aware of, I will try to highlight that. This definition contains two key concepts. The first concept is the concept of needs. So in particular, the essential needs of the world's poor, to which overriding priority should be given. Usually students find this concept of need very difficult to distinguish it from the concept of want. So I might think that I need an iPhone because it really helps me in doing my work in many different ways. But is it really a need? So the student has to clearly make a distinction between needs and wants. And a priority has to be always given to the essential needs, and most importantly, the activities that we do should not compromise the fulfillment of the essential needs of the world's poor. The next one, which is more implementable, the concepts of needs is something which is so broad, and also the fact that the whole problem of sustainability and unsustainability is slow moving. So for anybody, even a well-groomed professional who has a lot of expertise in the domain, for them predicting the same is quite difficult. However, the next one is very much more easier, but it's very key towards thinking for sustainability. The idea of limitations imposed by the state of technology and social organization on the environment's ability to meet present and future needs. So I already discussed about the problem related to CNG vehicles. So we did not have the technological, the scientific know-how at a point of time. Let's take another example, DDT as a pesticide. DDT was used extensively in a given time because its bad impact on the environment was environment and human health, animal health was unknown. However, DDT still is present in even babies born today, because it takes a long time for all the harmful chemicals to disappear from the environment. So that's about the limitation imposed by the state of technology. Another problem which is way much more difficult to tackle is the problem due to social limitations. Take any festival of any religion. It involves use of many things which are not really very good for the environment. Now, if we do it under certain numbers, the environment can regenerate itself. But considering how large our population is and how many, I say for example, how many idols we might be buying, and how many crackers we might be blasting. So now the whole system gets overburdened. So the system's sustainability comes into question. However, it's very difficult to convince people that do not perform the same practice. So let's say, for example, there are huge campaigns which run before the Ganesh festival or before Diwali, which tries to tell people that there are other alternatives available which are better for the environment, and let's adopt it. Constantly there will be lots of resistance to the change. Things will come like, this is our culture and this is an attack on our culture and so many other things. So it's a very difficult to tackle problem. Not that it is impossible to tackle. So because of so many information generation campaigns which have happened, the use of crackers have gone down to certain extent in many places. So say for example, if nowadays I ask my students, how many of you love to burst crackers? I see most of the class telling me that no, we don't do that because it causes pollution. I am amazed at the effect which all these awareness campaigns have caused, have reached. But these awareness related things have to be put in place. Also, alternatives have to be there. I usually want to have the fun which is involved in celebrating those festivals or enjoying that way of life. So we need to create those solutions. At the same time, we need to create awareness regarding the same. So all definitions of sustainable development require that we see the world as a system that connects space and a system that connects time. So space, so the entire globe. So somebody does pollute air in North America, that will affect air quality in Asia, and so on. World as a system over time. So if my grandparents use DDT, it is still having an impact on me to this particular day. So one has to consider the world as a system over space and time. Plus, very importantly, as a system of as quality of life is a system. So it's good to be physically healthy, but what if you are poor and don't have access to education? It's good to have a secure income, but what if the air in your part of the world is unclean? And it's good to have freedom of religious expression, but what if you can't feed your family? So we define the quality of life also as a system. I need a lot of different things in my life to happen the right way in order for me to have a good quality of life and the perception of a good quality of life. So one has to also take care of this particular aspect when one is designing for sustainability. So say for example, if it is difficult to adopt a sustainable way of living, let's say in a building which is designed for which is designed as a let's say as an office space, it needs to have adequate thermal comfort for its occupants. In the name of sustainability, nobody would like to have a thermally uncomfortable space to work in. So one has to take into consideration quality of life as a system as well. So the concept of sustainable development is rooted in systems thinking. It helps us understand ourselves and our world. The problems we face are complex and serious, and we can't address them in the same way we created them. So that's the whole point about design thinking. And it is achieved at the confluence of the three constituents. So now I will give you certain examples of design approaches which can be done. So there are four categories of design approaches which one can select from. So the first one is selection of resources with low environmental impact. So if I want to make a new car, I can identify the different resources that goes into it, and I can try to identify alternative resources. So if I am using if the car is made up of a certain grade of aluminum alloy, then I can see whether the same weight to strength ratio can be achieved through certain kind of alternate products which have a lower environmental impact. So in this particular approach, I called it as a product innovation level. So where I'm trying to innovate on the components of the product. The second approach also falls under the category of product innovation level. Here I try to design products with low environmental impact. So what I can try to do over here is, rather than taking the car and its individual components and trying to find out alternative resources with lower environmental impact, I can do an entire life cycle assessment of the product and try to identify during in the entire life cycle what are the points at which the environmental impact is high and how can I reduce the impact. So if in the manufacturing the impact is highest, I can see whether I can do something over there. If during the use phase the impact is highest, if a particular component has the highest wear and tear, let's say for example, I can try to redesign that particular component. So I can also have a functional approach. So let's say I want to create a more environment friendly way of washing clothes. So rather than designing more environment friendly washing machine, I can think of the whole functional aspect. So like washing machine is about churning the about removing dirt from the clothes. So can I create let's say a machine which doesn't require any kind of detergent but uses ultrasonic waves to vibrate the dirt out of the clothes. So in design of products with low environmental impact, because I'm considering the entire life cycle, I have the possibility to redesigning the embodiment, redesigning any of the life cycle stages, or redesigning the functional aspects in order to get better environmental performance. But all of these are product level innovations. The third one is product service system design for eco-efficiency, where I am doing an intervention at the product plus the service system. So let's say if I own a washing machine, I might be using, if I have a family of 4 or 5 people, I might be using the washing machine daily, but let's say for an hour or two. Whereas if I am a single person household or 2-person household, I might be using the washing machine in 3 or 4 days or maybe once in a week. So all the material and the energy which is embodied in that washing machine and all the pollution, all the emissions which has been caused due to the manufacturing process, the whole impact is divided over lesser number of usages in the context of an ownership based model. Whereas if you look at the washing machine thing, why do we need a washing machine? It's not that I need a washing machine. All I need is clean clothes. So I can also look at it from a product plus service approach. So let's say if there is an apartment complex consisting of 10 houses. Hello, is somebody trying to say something? Can I continue? In this particular context, I can have a washing machine which is shared by everybody in the building. So then the what I am subscribing to is a service. So whenever I need the washing machine, I can go and use it. And once I'm done, it is available for others to it. So if in the building, everybody uses the washing machine once in a day for an hour, the same washing machine can be used for 10 hours in a day. So the density of usage increases. So as a result, the impact So as a result, I will have to produce lesser number of washing machines. So rather than 10 washing machines, I will be producing only one washing machine. So the resource consumption reduces and density of usage increases. So the environmental impact is divided over larger number of usages. So product service system has a good potential for creating sustainable systems. The highest level is the design for social equity and cohesion, where we take into account a particular spatial and social requirement. So let's say Ladakh as a space is very different from Rajasthan as a space. And people living in a particular region in Rajasthan will have different social contexts of living. So when we are taking into consideration the geographic conditions, the social conditions, and trying to design something, or things like Amul. So Amul has a social innovation where they brought in so many milk producers together, put together on the system. So that's a social innovation. Then they have the technical innovation that they design. So they were the first people in the world to create a technological solution for processing buffalo milk. So that's a technological innovation. So they consider certain social aspects, certain technical aspects, and did innovation across both to create a sustainable system. So these are the four approaches which can be taken when one is trying to design for sustainability. So I will discuss more on the product innovation level, considering the fact that most people in the group are engineers, and it is more relevant to this particular domain. It's more relevant to the skill sets which engineers have. So the product innovation level has several methods in it. Green design, eco design, emotionally durable design, design for sustainable behavior, cradle to cradle design, biomimicry design, and design for base of the pyramid. So first one, green design. The main focus of this philosophy is lowering environmental impact through redesigning individual qualities of individual products. So the mantra over here is reduce, reuse, and recycle. So for example, a few years ago, an empty half liter water bottle weighed 22 grams. Now it's only 8.5 grams. So they have, in order to achieve the same, you have to build in better corrugations. One should be able to simulate the corrugations in appropriate software tools. See how the behavior of the bottles will be when it is loaded with certain amount of weight. Also, the machines in which these bottles will be blow molded needs to be refined so that they can produce thinner cross-section products. As a result of all these developments, the amount of the material which goes in these plastic bottles has significantly reduced over the years. Most printers are designed for reuse, so one can reuse parts of the whole product in design for new products. Replacing virgin material with recycled material, so whenever the context allows, so let's say in this particular example, the crates, it does allow the use of recycled material rather than virgin material. Replacing hazardous or toxic material with non-hazardous ones. So for example, these are pencils, color pencils. So usually we will see on the back of the color pencil, in order to identify the color, they put a color on top of it, which is basically addition of toxic material. Colors are always toxic in nature. Until and unless they are not organic. However, this company came up with a simple idea. Let me just do a chop off of the back of the pencil, as a result of which I can see the color. So I don't need to add this additional layer of toxic material. use of renewable energy also falls under this particular category. Improvement in efficiency of products and processes is also an example of green design. So in while conducting green design, one has to take care of designing for recycling and recyclability, which implies that the product has to be designed for being able to be dismantled and dismantled at a commercially viable scale. Also, a good approach can be designing it for repairability, so which implies it can be used for a longer duration of time. However, extending the technical life of certain products beyond a certain limit might not be in favor of environmental good. So let's say, for example, air conditioner, which is 20 years old, is no longer performing well when it is consuming electricity. So it is better discarded than kept on being used again and again. So every product should have a appropriate lifespan during which it should be used and beyond which it should be dismantled and the components can be reused. However, limitation of green design is it promotes green consumerism. So many a times I would like to buy a product which comes with the green label. Let's say, for example, in on Amazon, there are lots of trash bags which are being sold with this statement that it is recyclable because it is made up of virgin plastic. Now, anybody who has a technical knowledge of what virgin plastic means, it's just plastic granules which has been used for the first time for making anything. So they will know that the characteristics does not have any implications on recyclability. And recycling of extremely thin bin liners has a different kind of challenge. So it is not done actually. So through false information, green consumerism can be promoted because an actual consumer might not have any way of understanding that this is good or bad. Also, one might be confused. So let's say if I say a 5-star air conditioner consumes less energy, yes, of course, it does consume less energy. But overall, it has led to, because now it consumes less energy, more and more people can afford to buy it. The overall energy consumption has grown up. So people might think that they are doing something good because they do not know about the overall impact of the whole activity. So the limitation is promotion of green consumerism, which in totality can be bad. It focuses predominantly on single issues, therefore does not provide significant environmental impact gains. So let's say if I design an air conditioner which is more energy efficient, but I am not able to take into consideration how people use it. So I am not able to do any intervention in that point of time. So I am able to focus on a single issue. I might focus on that single issue very nicely, but I will not be able to make significant gains because people might not be using it the right way. The next strategy in this product innovation level is eco-design. So here the focus is on lowering environmental impact by looking at the whole life cycle of products from extraction of raw materials to final disposal. So it enables profiling of the environmental impact of products across the life cycle phases. So let's say an air conditioner, its highest impact is during its usage phase because it consumes a lot of energy. By doing life cycle assessment over the entire life cycle, I will be able to figure out which all areas should I intervene in order to reduce the environmental impact to the best degree. Thus, identification of highest environmental impact phases are possible. This provides the possibility of design interventions with a strategic direction. We use life cycle assessment methods. It also helps us in comparing different product choices as well as different life cycle process choices, different material choices. Life cycle assessment is also very important if somebody wants to sell their solutions in the European Union market, they need to have a environmental product declaration along with their product. So there are lots of softwares available to do that. So Sigma Pro and Gavi are excellent softwares, but they are expensive. There are other softwares like OpenLCA, which are available free of cost. Some of the databases are available free of cost, whereas other databases that one needs to use are paid. Still in the Indian context, we are into the process of developing context-specific, geography-specific databases. For students, if all these softwares are not available, they can also use this app, which is available on the App Store on both Android and Apple App Store. The app gives a list of materials and processes and electricity mix and so on, even for different kinds of food items. And one can do a comparison on eco cost and carbon footprint and make a selection accordingly. Anybody, if they are more interested in knowing how this is to be done, I have a YouTube video on the same. So I have an online course on the SWAM platform on system design for sustainability, which covers in detail how to conduct a life cycle assessment and how to do design for sustainable product services and all. The lectures are also available on YouTube, so you can do a search with the keyword system design for sustainability and you can find the all the lectures. So the aim here is to minimize natural resources and energy consumption and the impact on the environment in terms of emissions and waste. However, there are some limitations also for this particular process. It focuses only on the environmental problem and it disregards problems which cannot be accounted for in life cycle assessment, like social acceptance, impact of a design intervention. So let's say if I say that washing clothes without detergent by using ultrasonic waves is a better solution. But will that be acceptable to people? Because we have lived generation after generation washing our clothes with soap and water. Will I be able to accept that particular solution? So life cycle assessment doesn't take into account that. Similarly, impact due to the consumption pattern. So let's say batteries. I can use the battery and then I can do a possible, I can do an appropriate disposal of the battery. But how many of us do that? Hardly anybody of us do that, which again cannot be accounted in the life cycle assessment. So although less environmentally damaging ways of battery disposal or let's say Tetra Pak recycling are present, but it fails because people do not do their part in the whole thing. Associated efficiency gains did not resolve the impact due to ever-increasing consumption. Like I gave the example of the air conditioner, they have become more and more energy efficient, but because their cost of ownership has gone down, so more and more people have bought the same. So even if you go to smaller shops, even lower middle income groups can now afford to have a air conditioner. So overall, the consumption has gone up. A technical perspective with a limited attention to human related aspects like user behavior in use phase. So those are the limitations. Why I am bringing in the limitations also, each of those approaches are good approaches to take. They might be the only viable approach in a given context because of monetary constraints, time constraints, because what the client needs. However, one should, while designing, one should also be conscious about the limitations of it. So in case it is possible to take it to a higher level, one should always target the higher level possible. This one is the third one, which talks about emotionally durable design. So here the focus is strengthening and extending in time the emotional attachment between the user and the product. So it tries to address psychological obsolescence created due to users' perceived needs, desires for social status, emulation, or new trends in fashion and style. So I might want to change the interiors of my living room just because I have moved to a higher social status and I want to showcase that. Or maybe the latest trends and fashion are not in line with what I have right now, so I would want to change. Also, lots of products, especially technology related products, are nowadays designed considering that they should become quickly obsolete. That's a different kind of a problem that I'm not tackling in this, because that's something which is designed intentionally by the companies. What here I'm talking about emotionally durable design, where everything which can be technically still be useful, I create some kind of emotional attachment so that the user feels like using it for a longer time rather than just discarding it. So designers explore product user relationship and the role of design in strengthening the same. Some ways of doing it are enabling product personalization, designing products that age with dignity, designing product that allows users to capture memories. So say, for example, this is a product. So this is a lamp. When you buy the lamp, it's a black panel. So in order for the lamp to be a lamp, you will have to scratch the black panel and remove that coating in order for the light to come out. Now, when you are doing the whole process, you are transferring your personality into that. You are transferring your memories or whatever you are transferring into it. And then it becomes your lamp. So the chances that you will not like to discard that lamp because fashion changed, or because you want to change the decor or something like that, is quite high, because it involves your involvement in making the product the way it is. This is an example of designing products that age with dignity. So anything made up of, say, teak wood, sisham wood, they, as the wood ages, it has a different kind of beauty altogether which is coming in. So one would not like to discard their beautiful furniture because they have aged with dignity. However, there are certain limitations to this particular aspect also. So it's particularly challenged to effectively stimulate product attachment. The same product can generate different meanings and different degrees of attachment on different individuals. So we cannot exactly predict how much attachment will a particular product create for all the different people to whom it is going to belong to. Also, product attachment is less relevant for utilitarian products. Like, I will not feel attached to my washing machine because it's a utilitarian product. But some people might feel very attached to their washing machine just because it was gifted to them by someone very special. So then again, we come back to the first problem, that the same degree of attachment is not going to happen. And now this gifting thing is not possible to design into the system. It is somebody's choice to make that gift. Also, certain categories of product extending their longevity beyond a certain point might not be environmentally beneficial because they are no longer efficient enough in consuming, say, water or electricity or other resources. The biggest problem is manufacturers might be averse to implement product attachment strategies because this might lead to reduction in the sales volume. The next one in this category is called as design for sustainable behavior. So here the focus is on making people to adopt a desired sustainable behavior and abandon an unwanted unsustainable behavior. So for example, products which consume energy during their use phase, a substantial environmental impact is caused due to this and can be brought down by sustainable usage behavior. So let's say again go back to the air conditioner. So if my air conditioner, when I switch it on and the default setting is 18 degrees, then it might be a normal thing that I come back home from work and I switch on the air conditioner and I go out to get some water, or maybe I go to the washroom and the air conditioner is running. I might come back half an hour later. So for all those people who have this kind of behavior, if the AC by default started at 18, there will be huge losses of energy for this entire half an hour, and they might not need the same temperature. However, if the air conditioner automatically starts at 24 degrees, then in this half an hour, there is lesser energy waste. Now let's say the AC is able to detect whether people are there in the room or not. And if it is able to detect that there is nobody, it can sound a beeper. So in that case, if I don't want the room to be cooling down without me being present, I can go and switch it off for the time being. Or let's say my air conditioner gives me the information that today you have consumed 10 units of energy. With the information, I might also decide to do some kind of sustainable behavior. The air conditioner might be equipped with a button, which is the sleep button. So when the air conditioner detects that there is not much movement happening, so it can go to a higher temperature because the bodies are now cold enough and they do not need to run. So let's say 25, now it can still run at 26 and make everybody comfortable and consume less energy. So whenever there are these kind of interventions, what the designed product is doing is it is helping people adopt a more sustainable behavior, either by giving them information or by making it easier for them to adopt the behavior. So basic principles in this approach are: make it easy for people to adopt a desired behavior, make it harder for people to perform an undesired behavior. So when I make the AC at 24 default setting, so usually it is observed that people are equally reluctant in, so if it is 18, then equally do not bother to move it to higher temperature, or if it is at 24, do not bother it to move it to a lower temperature. If they are planning to move out, if they are going to stay in the room, they might bother. So for all those people who are not bothered about changing the setting, whatever it is, then it can be made to start at a default where they do not do an undesired behavior. So as a result, it has been a government rule that air conditioner's default setting has to be 24 degrees. The rule had been made just to cater to these kind of people. Making people want a desired behavior, so that can be done through knowledge, where we try to make people aware that this is going to be the impact of your activity, and making people not want to do an undesired behavior. Knowledge can be used, punishments can be used for the above one, making people want a desired behavior. Again, giving prizes can be used. However, the effect of a prize or a punishment is always short-lived. Hence, one needs to constantly keep on considering that. Also, the impact of any knowledge is not very long-lived. So one has to constantly also keep that, reminding people as long as it doesn't become a habit. So when it becomes a habit, then it stays for a longer time frame. So let's say, for example, this is a very simple intervention, which is like it's a power aware cord. So depending on the amount of energy being consumed, the power starts glowing more and more. So it's a way of very indirectly giving information to the user that you are using a lot of power. And if the user wants to switch off some of the not required products, then they can select that. So here the knowledge aspect is being delivered. Enabling users to adopt a healthier lifestyle. So like this particular advertisement is trying to say that this is a fresh harvest, it's an organic harvest, and it's good for health. Acting more safely in built environment, so that indoor air quality is maintained. Again, that can be also a part of sustainable designing for sustainable behavior. This one also has its limitations. A big question is about the ethical implications of applying design for sustainable behavior, like who is entitled to drive user behavior. Lack of metrics to measure the effect of this particular strategy and a lack of evidence based on examples is another problem. Implementing DFSB might require the use of additional materials as well as resources. Business stakeholders might not be incentivized in implementing this strategy because this might not be counterbalanced by financial gains. The next one is about nature-inspired design. It is called as cradle-to-cradle design. This is very interesting. And the basic fundamental over here is emphasize on a regenerative approach by industry and closing the loops. Focus on non-human species and future generations. So what it tries to say that in any product, let's say for example, a shirt, if the shirt is made up of organic fibers like cotton or silk or wool, so at the end of the life of the shirt, the cloth part of it should go into the biological cycle. And it where the shirt can have some buttons or zippers, which might be made up of plastic or metal. So the plastic and the metal are the technical products, and they need to go in the technical cycle. So either recycled and made into newer buttons or any other product. So the whole fund principle says that if products can be designed to either go into the biological cycle or the technical cycle at its end of life, it is very good for the environment. However, there is a big limitation to this particular aspect. What it doesn't consider is that waste and emissions from biological materials at high concentration may also create human health hazard. So if we consider our the huge population, and if all of us try to consume in that particular manner, just the volume of waste and emissions might be so high that the earth cannot regenerate it at the rate at which we are producing it. Now, technological nutrients, even if it would be possible to establish 100% efficient cycles with no material quality or quantity loss, these cycles would still need to be fed with new virgin materials in order to feed the promised continuous growth. So I buy the shirt today, but I might be using it for next 4 years. And in the same time, I would be buying other shirts also. So in this full time, how does this company produce more shirts? They cannot wait for my old shirt to come back and then the buttons go into their So they need to constantly keep on using new virgin material. Shift in focus of design decisions from the entire life cycle of products to minimizing or eliminating toxic materials can potentially result in overlooking impacts of energy consumption, especially at the consumption and use phase. So in this particular methodology, it does say that, so if you look at the points, it says 100% renewable energy use, but that is in the manufacturing process, in the use and consumption phase, you are not doing the same. Material reutilization, recyclability or compostability, material health impact on human and environment. So in cradle to cradle also, there are lots of, so it's a certification system. So there are lots of levels of certification that you create, and it doesn't consider the consumption phase energy consumption, which can be can have detrimental effects on the environment. The next one is nature-inspired design, which is biomimicry design. Mimicking the nature can happen at the form level, at the product level, or the system level by using nature's models, measures, and mentors. So the studying the models, adapting them to solve the human problem, using those ecological standards to judge the rightness of the innovation. So as I mentioned, the mimicking can happen at the form, process, and the ecosystem level. If the mimicking is just at the form level, then the sustainability potential might be either zero or very little. At the process and ecosystem level, you can get good sustainability. So what can be an example of a form level? And let's say an aeroplane's body is designed considering the form of certain is inspired by from certain biological phenomena. Now the inspiration was not taken into consideration from the perspective of sustainability. So the main reason the biomimicry was done in that case was the fact that it needs to fly, so it needs to understand how it can fly. Then there are certain cars, let's say, which are designed inspired by a certain animal. So in that case, it's more about aesthetics and not at all about sustainability. So at the form level, it is very difficult to comment whether anything is being done for the sustainability or not. But the process and ecosystem, we can do it much better. Say, for example, Lotusan is a paint which has been developed by understanding the process by which lotus leaves stay clean. So the lotus leaves have very tiny micron-sized droplets of a wax kind of a material, which are spaced at certain micron level distances, as a result of which when water falls on it, it makes a particular contact angle, which results in the water droplet falling off. Now, a similar principle was used to create this particular paint, in which, of course, they are not exactly mimicking the wax coating and the micron level design. They are taking the functional inspiration, and by mixing appropriate material, they are trying to create the same kind of contact angle so that the water droplets falls off. And when the water droplet is falling off, it will take away the dirt along with it. So these kind of paintings, when they are applied on certain building exteriors, they will when there is rain, the building surfaces will get clean. As a result of it, the amount of energy required in repainting the building or cleaning the building exteriors goes substantially down. There are several methods and tools for doing these particular activities. So you can go through them if you are interested and if your students are interested in it. There are certain limitations to isolating a principle, structure, or process from nature, and imitating it does not necessarily yield to sustainability, especially when it is done merely at the level of form and sometimes also at the process level. At the ecosystem level, it might function much better. At the production consumption level, it lacks any transformative potential. It also does not influence any psychocultural patterns. This is the last one in the category of product to innovation level, and it's for design for the base of the pyramid. So it's meant for improving lives of people who live at the base of the pyramid through market-based solutions. So your BOP is economically the poorest part of the global population. Many researchers set the limit of this as $2 or less per day of income. BOP is also characterized by a lack of access to basic services like public health, sanitation, education, and so on. They also face various social, cultural, and political exclusions. Now, the whole reason for looking at, for delivering the market-based solutions is that way the poor can be looked as consumers and not as victims. So market-based approach rather than aid-based approach. However, in this market-based approach, again, there are two other approaches. One in which the BOP is seen as a consumer. So where the business focuses is on selling products and or services to those at the base of the pyramid. So for example, I want to sell shampoo to the poorer people, but I know they cannot buy a bottle which is 100 rupees. But they can buy sachets of shampoo which will cost 1 rupee or 2 rupee and suffice the need of one time wash. So here I am trying to sell them products. So I'm looking at them as a consumer. This does have its drawbacks also. So the volume of shampoo that they are going to buy in 100 rupees is going to be way much more less than what I will buy by buying a bottle out of 100 rupees. So it's a way of economic exploitation as well. Plus these sachets, they are multi-layer packaging. So one cannot separate out all those layers. And they are a big reason for clogging of drains and a lot of unsustainabilities due to that. The other approach is BOP as a producer, where the focus is on sourcing products and or services from those at the base of the pyramid. And the aim also, let's say Fab India, it sources its products from the craftsmen. And as a result of which you are trying to improve their socio-economic context, and as a result of which they will enter the market economy. However, there are certain limitations in this. So targeting the poor as consumer has raised criticism. There is this moral dilemma that BOP approaches do not differentiate between satisfying essential needs and offering non-essential goods. So we come back to our two essential aspects of the sustainable development. So they are buying shampoo sachets, but is it an essential need or having nutritious food a more essential need? That poverty can be alleviated by simply targeting the poor as consumers. Poverty cannot be alleviated that way. There is another kind of an approach, which is the product service system design approach for base of the pyramid, designing for sustainable solutions. So this is one example. So this is a RO-based water purifier, supposed to be used by a community of people. So one pays per unit of water that they are using. Because you are paying per unit of water, you will not tend to waste water. It doesn't give you pouches of water. Like Indian Railways gives you a small pouch of water, which is like a one-time consumption of water after the lunch or dinner, which is the same as the shampoo sachets. In this case, we are not giving pouches of water. They are supposed to bring their own containers. So I do not create a lot of waste due to these additional containers. People will not waste the water because they are paying per unit of water that they are using. Since it is a community installation, so it serves a large number of people. So the embodied material and the energy and the emissions is distributed over larger usage volume. Base of the community, people can afford this product. So they get access to good quality drinking water. This is a example of a product service system where I'm being given the service of clean drinking water and I'm paying per unit of clean drinking water. So a move towards product service system design is nowadays a very well researched and well targeted topic. However, at the industrial scale, its adoption is still being worked on because there are lots of challenges. It requires innovation in business model. It offers wider opportunities for addressing the complex set of requirements that characterize BOP projects, developing solutions capable to meet three sustainability dimensions. So the assumption in these innovations is that it may act as business opportunities to facilitate the process of social economic development in emerging and low income contexts by jumping over or by passing the stage of individual consumption or ownership of mass produced goods towards a satisfaction based and low resource intensive advanced service economy. So if we move back to a couple of generations, usually consumption and ownership were not so much linked. So there would be common facilities, so common wells, common tube wells from which people would get, let's say, water. So the acceptance of consumption and ownership is something which is a more recent phenomenon. But nowadays we connect ownership to our social status. Ownership to, let's say, things like hygiene also in certain contexts. So let's say I wouldn't want to use a shared washing machine because of hygiene concerns. But the whole fundamental of this PSS innovation is, can we develop appropriate products and services and solutions which can bypass this need to connect consumption and ownership and go towards more like a service economy. So we can already see examples of things like Uber and Ola. They just went ahead with this service economy principle and they became pretty well accepted and popular solution. So product service system innovation level, the focus is beyond individual products towards integrated combination of products and services. They can be defined as a mix of tangible products and intangible services designed and combined so that they are jointly capable of fulfilling customer needs. Now, these can be both for the B2C market and also for B2B market. Let's say, for example, for all those industries who are trying to adopt more and more of smart manufacturing or adopting the various principles of Industry 4.0, when they are also moving more and more towards the service economy, because a lot of part of their activities can be outsourced to certain kind of service providers. So our PSSs can be designed for both B2B context as well as for B2C context. So PSS are value propositions oriented to satisfy users through the delivery of functions instead of products. So I want the function which is like clean drinking water and I am not interested in the product per se. So PSS tries to, when a designer is supposed to follow the PSS thinking process, they are supposed to first question what are those functions which users need and not what are the products that they need. So PSS design can be aimed at eco-efficiency, can be aimed at sustainability, where I consider all the three dimensions, and it can be also aimed at bottom of the pyramid. So the whole question over here is, does my customer need washing machine or do they need clean clothes? And then I can start thinking in many different ways. Maybe I can come up with a different kind of fabric which does not need much cleaning. So which I call it as the unit of satisfaction. So again, the unit of satisfaction is not air conditioner. The unit of satisfaction is thermal comfort. And then I can think of many different ways in which I can offer the same. Same goes with the context of water. So my unit of satisfaction is not a water purifier, but it is clean, safe drinking water. So PSS system innovations may act as business opportunities to facilitate the process of social economic development in emerging and low-income contexts by jumping over or bypassing the stage of individual consumption or ownership of mass-produced goods towards a satisfaction-based and low-resource-intensive advanced service economy. So here we need to think about shifting from a consumption based on ownership to a consumption based on access and sharing. So like solar water heating system. So maybe a neighborhood owns this thing and a couple of people together subscribe to this system and the company still owns the infrastructure. So upfront expenses goes down for the consumer. So they would like to opt for this because then you are paying way much lower than what you would pay for electricity bills. So they only pay for the amount of hot water that they use. Since manufacturers keep the ownership of the products and deliver a performance to customers, they are economically incentivized in reducing as much as possible the material and energy resources needed to provide that performance. This is another example from a particular, from the lubricant industry, Luber Lubricant Services. So earlier they were into the business of selling lubricants to industries. They came up with the idea of PSS where they said that industries specialize in manufacturing whatever they are manufacturing. They do not have people specializing in lubricants. So they might underuse their lubricant or overuse their lubricant, leading to damages and efficiency losses for their machines. So now Kluber is the expert. So they came up with this service called Kluber Slate Services. So they designed a vehicle which was equipped with all the machinery which could go from each company, each manufacturing unit to the next where their product and services are being used. They would check the health of the lubricant right now being used. If the lubricant is spent, then their vehicle would extract the spent lubricant and refill the machine with the required amount of fresh lubricant. Because the spent lubricant can be appropriately disposed of by Kluber, it is quite environmentally friendly. Otherwise, the company would have just disposed them off in the regular way. Sorry, give me a moment. Sorry for the disruption. They could do a better disposal of the spent lubricant. Also, the spent lubricant could be refined and can be used for lower grade purposes. So what the company would do is also compensate back for the lubricant that they would have extracted out, because now they could make another economic channel opens for them. So although their volume of lubricant sale reduced, their income increased because of this particular PSS, because more and more people subscribe to this service. The companies have a win-win situation because they don't need to worry anymore about the lubricant and about the efficiencies and so on. So PSS designed for eco-efficiency is an offer model providing an integrated mix of products and services that are together able to fulfill a particular customer demand. Based on innovative interaction between the stakeholders of the value production system, where the economic and competitive interest of the providers continuously seeks environmentally beneficial new solutions. It can offer the possibility to find new strategic market opportunities for companies, increase competitiveness, and establish longer and stronger relationships with customers. So like for anyone to come as a competition of Kluber, they have to spend so much more money to establish the entire service ecosystem. In the same time, Kluber would have established strong relationships with their customers. So these customers might not be very readily willing to switch to another one. So they build up barriers to entry for potential new competitors. So if I try to map all these different methods that I discussed, I did not discuss anything on the spatio-social level and the socio-technical level. I only discussed the product level and the product service system level. So you can see each one of these methodologies, they have certain requirements in terms of technological innovation. So if you look at the scale, so I have technology going up to people. So in green design, the technological innovation is the highest, but people level innovation is not happening. So which means we are not taking into consideration behavior of people, consumption behavior, or their psychological requirements and so on. So technological innovation is high, but people related innovation is not so high. When I am talking about emotionally durable design, I am talking about increasing the people level. I might also include certain technological innovations also, but in emotionally durable design, what I'm trying to talk more about is including more and more of people, but it is still more technology centric. Whereas if you see the product service system, they can actually involve product level innovation, product service system, spatio social and socio technical. Depends on how many different things the designer can bring into picture under the constraints of time, resources, and so on. You can read more about all these different methodologies in this very interesting paper. It's called as Evolution of Design for Sustainability from Product Design to Design for System Innovations and Transitions. There are also some engineering design criteria and guidelines which can be used by students very interestingly when they are trying to do a particular research. So these are available in this particular book called Design for Environmental Sustainability. How these are structured? So there are criteria are minimize material consumption, minimize energy consumption, minimize toxic emissions, use renewable and biocompatible resources, optimization of product lifespan, and improve lifespan of materials. In order to do all these things, the seventh one, design for disassembly. In order to do the same, they have certain sub-criteria and guidelines. So we will pick up the first one, which is minimize material consumption. To do that, one can minimize material content, minimize scraps and discards. So when a student takes up these guidelines, it will help them in the design process. So not that all of them will be applicable, but let's say minimizing material content is applicable to them, they can take up that. So it further goes into, so if I select minimize material content, it has some guidelines, design guidelines. So like they can dematerialize the product or some of its components, or they can avoid oversized dimensions, digitalize the product or some of its components, and so on. So this is how the whole thing is structured. So it is very useful for students because they really do not know about the entire process. This can be also used by professionals because there are so many things which can be done. So in the absence of a guideline, we might just also miss out onto some of these aspects. I have a course on the SWAYAM platform. So the course is running since 2018. It's running this time also. We are almost halfway, we are a little bit more than halfway through the course. However, if you go into the NPTEL website, you will find the entire content. The content can be also found on YouTube. So you have to search with the keyword system design for sustainability and you can get the entire video lectures. Thank you so much for giving me a patient hearing. If you have any questions that I can try to answer.
Thank you so much, madam, for very valuable time and giving a lot of information, amazing us with the very important design aspects, madam. Different approaches and design aspects of sustainability, including limitations, will again very much really useful. So for design of products. So thank you very much, madam. Now it will be open to participants for any queries to raise. If you have any doubts, please. Participants.
Madam, thank you so much. So for your valuable lecture and your time actually, so we may be so troubling you, so for our students also regarding sustainable design. Okay, so we are running one sustainability course actually, open elective since last year, and this year we are offering minor degree for which we have took your help also to design the syllabus. No. So thank you very much for your cooperation and support, and we anticipate the similar support in future also in delivery of the courses also. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Have a nice day.
Thank you, ma'am. With your permission, I have meeting.
Thank you. Have a nice day. Bye, everyone.
Thank you, ma'am. Bye, ma'am. Raju garu, you take care. So I have meeting with CEO. I'm leaving.
Okay, sir.